All right, good evening. Welcome to Westmont Downtown. My name is Jacques Cabra. I'm one of the 25-plus Westmont College Foundation board members. And tonight I have the privilege of introducing our provost, Mark Sargent. And before I do that, I'd like to kind of tell you a little bit about what the foundation does. We really are building bridges between the community and the college. We do this a few different ways, putting on these lecture events, Westmont Downtown. Thank you for being here. And there's actually four events every year, so please check the calendar for upcoming events. And also the President's Breakfast. How many people have been to the President's Breakfast in the past? Great. Well, it's coming up on March 4th, and it features the commentator and author David Brooks. It'll be held at the Fess Parker, and there are still a few tickets available. So without further ado, I'd like to introduce Dr. Mark Sargent, the provost of Westmont College since 2012. Before that, Dr. Sargent was actually a provost at Gordon College, so he's been for a long time, since 1996. A graduate of UCSB, but do not fret, both his wife and his children both attended, all attended Westmont College. So please join me in welcoming Dr. Mark Sargent.
Thank you. Good crowd. Nice to see all of you out here for this evening. It's a testament, I'm sure, to Greg, who I have the pleasure of introducing. Each spring, this series begins with a session that's devoted to looking at the issues that are involved with the Westmont Down, the West President's Breakfast speaker. And as Jacques mentioned, our speaker this year is David Brooks. So we're pleased to have one of Westmont's finest faculty members, Dr. Greg Spencer, help us reflect on Dr. Brooks' work and thought. Dr. Spencer, or Spence, as he is often affectionately called, is a professor of communication studies who joined the Westmont faculty in 1987. He finished his Bachelor of Science degree in speech communication from Cal Poly, San Luis Obispo, and his Master of Science and PhD in communication from the University of Oregon. And I think he still is a loyal Ducks fan. Right. He's also an admired teacher. I regularly see him having lunch with our students in the dining commons. That means that he is, one, very popular. Two, he's a master at letting students know about our Take the Professor to Lunch program. In fact, I'm told that Greg and his wife, Janet, have probably attended more weddings of Westmont alums than anyone in history. His courses are known for their rigor and generally have very long waiting lists. Students count it a privilege to have a critique of their writing and their speech from Spence. They consider it a badge of honor. He teaches rhetoric, media ethics, and a course called Messages, Meaning, and Culture, which is an introductory theory course on the centrality of communications in our perceptions of reality. He is a very active writer. He's written a couple novels, The Welkening, and a sequel called Guardian of the Veil. And I understand that both of those books are available for purchase after our session this evening. His most recent book, which is also available in the back, is called Awakening the Quieter Virtues, which goes beyond the widely touted virtues like courage and decisiveness in the midst of crisis to explore some of the everyday virtues like innocence, discernment, and generosity, things that may actually play a more profound role in our lives and relationships on a daily basis. I've been told by some of his friends his virtues on the tennis court are not always quiet, that he does have a fierce two-handed backhand. He preaches and teaches in churches, dresses up in costumes to hand out candy to trick-or-treaters, has his students occasionally dress up in Roman togas for speeches, and appears regularly in Westmont's all-campus variety show, Spring Sing. Reportedly, on one occasion in Spring Sing, he played the image consciousness fairy, whose task it was to keep the MC mindful of the fact that he was not the center of the universe. That's a good cue for me as MC to get out of the way and hand the evening over to one of Westmont's most beloved and finest teachers, Dr. Greg Spencer.
Thank you, Mark, I think. Well, here we are to think, listen, talk about virtue. Who wants to do that? Evidently you do. You're here. I mean, you must care about virtue in our age, or else you were part of the Santa Barbara Film Festival and you're looking for Sylvester Stallone. But if you already care about virtue, why am I speaking to you? You know, a classic case of teaching those who already got the lesson. I mean, where are the reprobates when you need them? Reminds me of what C.S. Lewis once said. When you invite a middle-aged moralist to address you, I suppose I must conclude, however unlikely the conclusion seems, that you have a taste for middle-aged moralizing. I shall do my best to gratify it. So, whatever your purpose here, welcome. We're here to wade a bit into David Brooks, to dip our toe into his book, The Road to Character. Maybe to get knee-deep, even stride against the current. And along the way, I'll make some reference to my book, Awakening the Quieter Virtues, which is noisily available on the back table, and offer some analyses of our times, especially as related to communication and communication devices. So first, some themes in Brooks' book. And this is not working. And it's not working. And it's not working. It is changing. Oh, great. It's not changing here. So great. Wonderful. Now that you saw all that, this is, there we go. All right, well, I can't see that. That's odd. All right, but this works. Good to know. All right, so one theme in Brooks' book, he says we spend most of our time supporting the resume virtues when we should spend our efforts on the eulogy virtues. He says the resume virtues are the skills that you bring to the job market and that contribute to your external success. The eulogy virtues are deeper. They're the virtues that get talked about at your funeral, the ones that exist at the very core of your being, whether you are kind, brave, honest, or faithful, the kind of relationships you've formed. He wants us to consider what is wise. Now, some folks don't appear to be interested, as you already saw, as in this part of a t-shirt, I put the sin in Wisconsin, or urban decay perversion mascara, or born to be bad, or simply everyone's favorite coffee cup, I love evil. But wisdom isn't about being nice and boring. It's about cultivating good habits toward the good. And those habits can lead to considerable adventure, like when you have the courage to address those problematic business decisions that your boss is making, or you have the generosity to be with a friend who is struggling with the pain of her past. Our culture spends most of its time on the resume virtues of self-promotion. We're to focus on ourselves, and of course, everyone else should too. Ariana Grande has a new song called Focus. Oh, this is gonna be tricky because I can't see it. Hello, tell me when I'm on 45. Anybody? Great. And it doesn't go. All right, well, we won't listen to that. Sorry, I can't help. It's all right, we'll just go on. But let's just go back because the lyrics are profound. All right, so I wanted you to see the depth here. Focus on me, fa-fa, focus on me. Focus on me, fa-fa, focus on me. And then it just gets deeper and more profound as we go along. So we're told to focus on ourselves. But Brooks, especially in his eulogy virtues, encourages us to highlight humility. He says, humility is the freedom from the need to prove you are superior all the time. And you're thinking, well, who needs to prove it? It's pretty obvious. He cites Montaigne, who says, On the loftiest throne in the world, we are still only sitting on our rump. In my chapter on modesty and awakening the quieter virtues, I talk about preoccupation with the self. And there's a continuum here of thinking about how we are preoccupied with ourselves. We tend to think that self-focus is mainly about bragging about ourselves or dominating a conversation. But we can be just as self-focused negatively. We can be self-centered when we say, I hate myself, or look how terrible I am. In fact, modesty means that we temper a sense of our fullness with a recognition of our emptiness. It's a kind of paradox. In our basic state, we are preoccupied with ourselves, and it takes a lot of focus, Ariana Grande, to make any progress here, to learn to love our neighbors as ourselves. And this is important because humility is the condition of virtue. David Brooks writes that if we can see humility as foundational, then we are free to face our weaknesses and frame our lives in part as a moral struggle. I think this is one of his key insights in his book. He says, what do we know about people of character? What we know is that people of character understand their weaknesses and they address them. They are willing to engage in moral struggle with themselves, joyfully and compassionately. Sometimes we're not really sure that we want to do this. It just adds too much weight to the sadness of our times. But Brooks says that we need the character created by our own struggle in order to deal with the moral struggles of our times. Someone who put this quite well is Etty Haleesam. She wrote this not long before she entered Auschwitz and was killed there. So she's thinking about her times. She says, the greatest cause of suffering in so many of our people is their utter lack of inner preparation. So let's take a look at some trends in our culture that challenge our moral choices. Since my work is in communication ethics, I want to focus on some mediated messages and get us thinking about these things. Neil Postman, in his book Technopoly, writes, every culture must negotiate with technology, whether it does so intelligently or not. A bargain is struck in which technology giveth and technology taketh away. Given our technological culture, what is emphasized and what is neglected? What is overstated and what is understated? Postman says there are always gains and losses in all of our technological choices and uses. In the midst of the noise, what are some quieter concerns that we might have missed? Now, another way to think about Postman's reminder about technology is to remember that when we make decisions, we're not just involved in pursuing something, we are prioritizing things. We put some things above others, and in the moral realm, we are always sorting out a hierarchy of values. Which good is better? Paul famously did this in 1 Corinthians 13. He says, there is faith, hope, and love, but the greatest of these is love. It's a hierarchy of values. So I'd like to suggest a couple of these hierarchies that are present in our current culture. What's up? What's down? I'd like to propose two trends. The first trend is that yes is up and no is down. Yes, be free, be open, get experience, tolerate everything, give in, break boundaries, agree. A little bit like these ads. Yes, get the best 4G, whatever it says, internet service. It's not just don't do it. It's just do it. HBO now, not tomorrow, not in a week, now. And just more yes. Now, of course, yes is a great word. It's a wonderful response. It's one of the most beautiful words in the English language. It's a good thing. But I want to zero in on one particular yes of our times. What I think is the resolution of maybe 90% of the movies that are out there. It's follow your heart. Follow your heart is the yes of our times. And what do we mean by this? By follow your heart, we usually mean exercise unrestrained emotional choice. Do what you want. Indulge. Find your dreams. It's just about your choice. What is in your heart is good. And this is true for moral choices also. What's good is what we feel is good. Most of this time, this means simply follow your emotions, not your reason. I think this is one of the messages in the recent film Inside Out. I love the movie in many ways. It was a lot of fun. But the message of the movie is that emotions rule and that they ought to rule. I kept asking as I was watching, where is reason? Oh, it's that little train of thought. You know, where did it go? That little train of thought. And maybe this is one reason why we seem to have replaced I think with I feel. You know, we don't say I think Abraham Lincoln was a good president. We say I feel he was a good president. It's that presidential feeling that we have. By follow your heart, we also mean all that matters is pleasure. Spend your time having fun. Jim Farrell says that Americans are fundamentalists. Especially since television, one of our greatest fears is boredom. We've made hyperactivity, hyper-amusativity, a norm. I mean, God help us if we can't say that over the weekend we had fun. Sometimes it seems that this is the great accomplishment of our times. We may not be able to do anything, saw, build, repair, sew, create a good argument, but what we're really, really good at is entertaining ourselves. Sometimes I think, congratulations. And usually this means have an epic life. I mean, get it all, do the extreme, push the limits, extreme everything. I think our second daughter has done everything here. And maybe you'll end up like this. Now, I won't because I'm afraid of bridges. Just finish that bucket list of all the extravagant things that you can. It's part of what follow your heart means, and we demand of life what life can't deliver. And if follow your heart is the yes of our times, train your heart is the no of our times. No is, well, it's not a nasty word, I don't think, but we tend to demean anything that sounds like restriction or resistance or resignation. But the simple fact is that we get better through discipline and struggle and sacrifice. Brooks recognizes that some vices can be tamed only by what he calls habits of restraint. I mean, how are you going to get better at your anger problem unless you work at restraining that problem? Our culture often says, love yourself. And some of the wiser people in our culture say, know yourself. But very few say, know yourself. Brooks says that the key question is not, what do I want from life, but what are my circumstances calling me to do? And if our circumstances involve suffering, how can we suffer well? But more than this, he says, good can come out of suffering. we find out what we're made of. Suffering can be a school for the soul that, he says, shatters the illusion of self-mastery. A few years ago, I had a period of 2 years of pretty severe back pain. You could often find me on my floor in the living room in the fetal position. And I hated it. I mean, I did not rejoice in my suffering. Every night, I sat on the bed filled with dread. But during those 2 years, I think some things were trained in me. The pain broke me down mentally and physically. It knocked my arrogance, my illusion of self-mastery, down enough for me to consider that there might be emotional causes of my pain, not just physical causes. It also drove me to the discipline of certain exercises that eventually bore the fruit of strength. And it also taught me that I needed grace from my wife, who had to endure my weariness, from my mental and physical therapists, who helped me develop new habits, and grace from God, who remained a source of refuge and inspiration. Discipline is not all in all, but it is important if we are to train our thoughts. We don't get the courage of Martin Luther King Jr. by watching the movie Selma. Sitting on the couch will not train us to accept a beating for the sake of justice. We won't become a better friend by watching Frodo and Sam support each other on the way to Mount Doom. Now, don't get me wrong, I love those stories. And we may get inspired, and we may get instructed, we may get reminded, but getting entertained is not the same as marching into hell for a heavenly cause. So let's all sing. To dream. Oh, I made that. I don't know if you can read this. So secondly, we build community through disciplines of restraint. So we work on ourselves through habits of restraint, but we also build community. What makes a community work? In part, we live together in peace by saying no, by denying that impulse that says, go ahead, act on everything that irritates you. Go ahead, flirt with the secretary. We train our heart not to follow our heart, at least some of the time. Saying no to lying builds trust. Saying no to gossip fosters confidentiality. Saying no to rage nurtures justice. Saying no to lust leads to respect. Saying no to cynicism builds hope. So much of community life has to do with holding the tongue, denying the irritation, practicing forbearance. Now, of course, yes is so often wonderful, and no can be terrible. But love is what helps us decide between the two, not mere freedom. We must not merely follow our hearts, which could lead us anywhere, but train our hearts according to the demands of love. And a third part of this train your heart is to recognize that a commitment to training our hearts says that the long term is more important than the short term. It's a recognition, as Brooks writes, that character takes time. It's a long road. The long-term focus is life-building, life-giving. The short-term focus is often life-taking. So that's the first trend. The second trend is this. Time is up and space is down. In our culture, we tend to privilege qualities related to time. Speediness, urgency, over values of space, being in person, sharing our deeper selves with one another. Because of our technologies, time has risen as a moral commitment. I have to get back to you now. And space has become less important. As we negotiate with technology at this point, I think time is winning the debate. Now, in the old days, way, way back when the phone rang for dinner, you know, any of us might get up and interrupt a terrific conversation to take that call. It might be important, we said. So we sheepishly got up and took the call and came back and said, nah, it was only a telemarketer. Now, what were we talking about? Then we got caller ID, and we no longer had to take those calls. Yay! And what did we do with this freedom from interruption, this freedom to engage with others around the table? We each got our phones. And we put the phones on the table, screens up. And we gave higher priority to the phones, to calls, to texts, to emails, to the internet, than to the others in our presence. And we said, but it might be an emergency. Yeah, and you might win the lottery. I like phones. I use them all the time. I don't like calling them smartphones. Facebook can be fun. I have an account. Skype is great, especially when your grandkids are far away. You can see them over there. Well, maybe you can't. Maybe you need a better picture. Oh, there they are. Texting can be incredibly helpful. I'm on email all day. Isn't my PowerPoint cool? Well, okay, not really. But we need to take a good look at what participation with these forms of communication mean. All forms of communication get us leaning in certain ways. Television gets us to sit and look for entertainment, not just on the television. Advertising gets us to appreciate pithy slogans and think that buying something, anything, will make us happy. But we can become educated about the leaning and do our best to choose when to lean and when to resist the lean. And if we don't attend to what is going on, we will lean as the form encourages. So, time is featured. Time is up, space is down. Since chronemics, the role of time in communication, is up, I think an ethic of timely control is overstated. Timeliness is so emphasized in our world. Values of efficiency, our communication is short and to the point. Speed of response matters so deeply. In good Pavlovian style, we hear the ding of a text or an email and we salivate. Our anxiety rises. We feel the pressure. We just have to get it now, now, now. In his book, The Shallows, Nicholas Carr argues that not only is our attention span decreasing, our brains are actually getting rewired toward flitting and scanning, towards short bursts of attending, and away from going deep, from deep thinking, deep reading, and deep relating. We live in the shallows, struggling to attend to what is complicated, like maybe Westmont downtown lectures. Timeliness is a part of our increased issue of control. We want to send and receive messages on our terms, in the ways we can control. We want to send our messages and edit them, edit our texts. We want our photos, but we want to edit our photos. Avoid things that are out of our control, like the facial reactions of people in our presence. I ask one of my classes every year, why do you think there's so much anxiety among your peers? Why have appointments at the counseling center greatly increased? And they have. Why is suicide up? Now, they're not researchers. They're just reporting what they feel as members of this group. Here's what they say. They say that the expectations are so high for them that they make comparisons based on the perfect images that they see on social media. Why don't I have as much fun, look as fantastic, go to places as exotic? They feel the need, they feel the pressure of higher digital standards and the need to control their own images. Sherry Turkle has been a sociologist at MIT for years and has written books about screen time, about how we are alone together in American culture. And her most recent book is called Reclaiming Conversation. In it, she says, what we value most is control over where we put our attention. She says, our mobile devices seem to grant three wishes. First, that we will always be heard. Second, that we can put our attention wherever we want it to be. And third, that we will never have to be alone. That we will never have to be bored. Increasingly, we'd rather text than talk. That way, we stay in control. We can edit, we can send a Snapchat, an Instagram, we can pin it. We shy away from what is open-ended. Our attention to time has come at the expense of space. So, proxemics, the role of space in communication, is down. An ethic of hospitable presence is understated. An ethic of hospitable presence is understated. See if you resonate with some of these issues, some of these space-related problems, presence issues that are chosen for us. It seems to me there's a conspiracy against conversation and solitude. There are televisions everywhere. Wherever you go, in public places, in restaurants, in gas stations, I mean, whatever you do, let's stay distracted. There's music blaring everywhere. I went to the Rose Bowl a few years ago, and during halftime, I could not talk to the person standing next to me. The music was outrageously loud. Whatever you do, don't talk. And there are ads everywhere, filling up every minute while you're waiting for a movie, so there are no awkward silences in which you might actually have to converse. And there are presence issues that are choices that we make. We're on our devices everywhere, at lunch with friends, on hikes in nature, at committee meetings, faculty in committee meetings, and at church. Many of my students use the alarm on the phone to wake them up, and then they spend their first minutes of the day in bed, scanning their messages and their social media. Parents are on their phones all the time, when they pick up their kids, when they're with their kids, when they're with their kids. Sherry Turkle says that because of this, children do not expect their parents to be there with them. So, what are some consequences of these presence issues? The first is what I would call the norm of interruption. No matter how much effort was made to be in one's presence, the phone takes precedence. Urgency trumps presence. Scanning trumps attentiveness. Recently, a friend told me, this conversation feels so different. I'm not used to getting asked how I am. I think there's a sense of competition. I don't know if you feel it. I sure feel it. I feel a rivalry with the phone on the table. Can I keep your attention? Will you think that the phone's a better option than I am? And I think there's the disjunction between connection and detachment. We think we can have it both ways. We think we can be fully present, but fully connected elsewhere. At Westmont, whenever two or more are gathered, someone is on the phone. We forget the power of meta-messages, what is said beyond the immediate words, the straightforward message. If I say I'm listening, but I watch the screen, my meta-message conflicts with my message. If I think I'm saying that being in your presence matters, but I keep opting out of your presence, my meta-message is I have other priorities. The upshot is that ours is an age that claims to be connected, to be exceptionally interested in connection, but is often detached. And I think there's an immodesty in all of this. Those on their devices have a way of saying, it's about me. I'm more important. But we need to remember Techno Corinthians 13. If I answer my texts but have not love, I am just a dinging notification. So I ask, if presence is good, what do we gain by this kind of commitment, by a commitment to presence? Hospitable presence offers the potential of a high and holy gift, the gift of undivided attention. When I was in graduate school, I would often go to see my favorite professor. Many of my students know his name. And I would go up to his office and somebody would be in there talking with him. And I would wait and I would wait. And I would think, don't you think I'm waiting? I mean, come on, can you wrap up this conversation? And then I'd get really smart and I'd start pacing in front of his door. You know, like, okay, notice me. He never made eye contact with me. Never made eye contact with me. And this really ticked me off. And after a while, I figured it out. Because when I was in his office, he gave me the same uninterruptible attention. He valued immediacy. And I felt valued by him because he gave me this gift. Secondly, hospitable presence offers a dynamic uncertainty, open-ended conversations, interesting lines of inquiry, and a lack of predictability. It involves the whole person, emotions, intellect, values, the senses, eye contact, sound, smell, touch, and at a meal, taste. It involves the joys of empathetic relationships, identifying with one another, sharing our lives, rejoicing with those who rejoice, and weeping with those who weep. But here's the thing. These are the very qualities that speak to why we avoid deeper presence. Because we have not arrested our own self-centeredness, we do not want to give the gift of undivided attention. Because we want control of our image, we fear unpredictability. Because we have leaned away from presence, we feel increasingly insecure about and wary of engaging the whole person. Have you noticed this? As texting rises, the pressure not to call increases. The voice, the ring, feels like an intrusion, even when you know the voice is what is desired for personal support, or when a call would be such a better resolution than 54 texts back and forth. Some have said that because we are less frequently in one another's presence, we are losing the ability to interpret nonverbal cues. What does that facial expression mean? I forget. And how do I deal with silence? And because we maintain our distance, we are, in fact, distant. Sherry Turkle writes about the lost practice in the empathic arts. Learning to make eye contact, to listen, and to attend to others. She says that in the young, there is a flight from empathy. So I want to call for a renewed commitment to hospitable presence, to prize it, to respect it. We understand FaceTime. Maybe we need to revive face space. So let's consider first public hospitality. Hospitality involves respect for place. Public areas are not the same as private areas. A classroom is not a bedroom. A restaurant is not an isolated reception desk. A shared meal is not a solitary meal. When my mother-in-law met with her servers or cashiers or wherever we were, she would always ask these workers for their name and have a short conversation. She treated them as people, not as robotic servants according to their function. And I really loved that about her. So I wonder, might we muster the courage to speak to strangers when we are in line? Imagine that. To look up as we walk in public places and to say hello. Could we get off our phones long enough to notice and engage with others? And maybe you're thinking, well, yeah, that's all for the extroverts. And maybe you're right. But I think most of us can find ways to notice and help others feel noticed, even if it's just a smile. So let's take a look at private hospitality. And really what I mean here is conversation. With Sherry Turkle, I say, I'm not anti-technology, I'm pro-conversation. I mean, isn't meaningful conversation one of life's greatest goods, of life's highest pleasures? I mean, it's not as flashy as going to Disneyland or watching Star Wars or going on a sunset cruise, but my guess is that all of us would say that some of our best moments are sitting around a table, conversing, learning to know others and getting known ourselves, reminiscing with friends. But like all good things, conversation asks of us risk and skill, perseverance and creativity, and it requires protection, ethical protection. It requires that we make good judgments in relationship to it. It's the landscape of social interaction that needs to be protected like a national park. No building here. No unnecessary intrusion. Keep the trails and vistas clear and open. It's a skill we can work on. We can improve. How can I keep a conversation going without dominating and also without disappearing? How can we foster conviviality, communion, attentiveness, and other-centeredness? So I say, let's praise hospitality. I love what Stephen Nachmanovich says in his book, Free Play. He says, every conversation is a form of jazz. Isn't that great? You lay down a topic, and I take it up, and I play my variation on a theme, and I send it back to you, and then you riff on the theme, and it goes back and forth. Since we tend to lean where technology encourages us to lean, we need reminders, counterweights, to pull us back. Ethical commitments, principled reference points, and the virtues to support them. Good habits that keep us going toward wisdom. Brooks reminds us that to meet the moral struggles of our times, we must be willing to meet the moral struggles within our soul. So here are a few parting thoughts. Don't get too excited. You're going to check your phones. I know. I'm not quite wrapping up. So first of all, the trends I note here, what's up and what's down, are emphases that need correction, not mandates that are mutually exclusive. Rather than one precluding the other, one requires the other. So what I mean by this is, yeah, there we go. What I mean by this is, oh yeah, no, wait. It's not yes bad, no good. Time bad, space good. That's Tarzan ethics. Instead, we need to remember the relationship between these choices. Yes needs no. If you are to follow your heart, you need to train your heart. We can't follow our heart into piano mastery without disciplining ourselves to practice. We will not defeat the alien invaders because we have heart unless we are very skilled at stopping alien invaders. And the same goes for patience and cheerfulness and respect. And time needs space. If you want timely control to benefit community, you need to practice hospitable presence. Self-fulfillment requires community development. So I'm going to leave you with five principles that I have implied along the way. The first principle, when in doubt, choose life. Discernment is always appropriate. More than we realize, every day we are choosing between what is life-giving and what is life-taking. It's a good lens to use for evaluating between yes and no, time and space. Second, when you can, taste and see, not just see. What I mean by this is that we should choose the most senses that we can, not the least number of senses. Make your default choice to engage the most senses, the most nonverbal elements, not the least. So, can I hear you and see you and not just text you? We are not just words, we have bodies. We need to remember to smell the roses and not just Instagram them. Third, if you need to feed the dog, don't use a hammer. Choose the right tool for the job. And the right tool, as Sherry Turkle says, is not always the one in your hand. So Facebook when that's the best tool, and talk when that's the best tool. Let the form match the message. Fourth, meta messages matter. We're always communicating, whether we realize it or not. So may our messages be, when they can, you have my undivided attention. Fifth, home wasn't built in a day. Choose for the long term. A short-term orientation is a short-sighted orientation. As Brooks puts it, vice makes us short-termed, virtues long-termed. So let's keep talking about these things. I mean, here, after I'm done, but together. Because yes is up and no is down, because time is up and space is down, let's enter into an open-ended, fully present conversation about our times. It will take humility on all of our parts, but that's okay. As Brooks says, we're all stumblers. We're doing our best, and stumblers know they need others and the grace of God.